Well, that was fun. So, okay, we're all excited. We're going to work these satellites, aren't we? So, what do I need? Well, I need an FM radio. So, you know, bring out your trusty FT60 or whatever you got, because almost everything will work in. You need an antenna. Sometimes it could be a big antenna, like this stuff, or it could be a small antenna, like these. Obviously, aperture is important in all things RF, so the bigger the better. So, you know, if you want to really work them well, then you get a bigger antenna. One of the antennas that I've used when we've traveled, and I don't want to carry this stuff because it does fit in my suitcase, that antenna breaks down to this, and this will fit in my suitcase. And so when we travel and go back to see our family in Colorado, I'll take this antenna, and it breaks in half, and all the elements fold up in here, and I take it with me to Colorado or travel. I'll take it on business, and work the satellites when I have time. If I don't want to take that, I also keep one of these, and this is a prime 800
Eric? They don't make them anymore.
I know, but you can find something similar. Yeah. But this antenna, then you put this on your radio, and of course you have to orient it. So you typically, you're talking with the radio like this, upside down, because you're using the ground as a reflector, and the satellite is here. So you have to kind of move it around. But nonetheless, you can work the satellites and you can hear them, even with a simple antenna like this. And then you have to have knowledge of the passes, which is the orbital prediction. So you have to know when these things are going to come over. And all of us have smartphones. And if you don't have a smartphone, there's lots of resources on the web. Next slide. So again, minimal equipment, an FMHT, a Yagi, extended whip. And I mean, literally, this is it, guys. This is all you need right here.
Do you need a dual band radio?
You have to have a dual band radio. Thank you, Bruce. Yeah, it's got to be UHF, VHF. And there's various ways to program it. I'll show you a little bit about that. I like Yaesu radios because Yaesus do something that's very special, and that's that they operate split frequencies, which means that in a memory, you can put VHF and UHF on the same memory channel. So I can transmit on UHF or VHF and receive on VHF or UHF. And so when I transmit, I'm transmitting on one frequency, listening on the other. And then it's really simple, and you'll see this in a minute, you just program five memories into your radio, and you go click, 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 as the satellite moves from acquisition of signal to time of closest approach to loss of signal, and then it's over the horizon. Next. So, getting started. So, Patrick, maybe you could help me. Bruce, would you help me? This is some handouts.
He's got to run.
Oh, Rebecca will help. Mm-hmm. So, we'll pass those out. Those are flyers. This is available on the web at AMSAT.org. And a lot of things are available at AMSAT.org. But I made these this afternoon for all of you. This is kind of the cheat sheet to get you started. So, you know, save this, take it home. If you lose it, all you got to do is go back to AMSAT.org and look for basic operation hints and things. But this will give you some of the initial frequencies, how to set up your radio, give you hints to get started on operating the FM satellites. Next slide. So, FM radio. So let's talk about FM. Bruce, you had a couple questions earlier. You know, you just need an HT. I started with an FT60. A long time ago, I got really interested, talking to Patrick at dinner tonight, I started with an ICOM radio. But really, I really hit the ground running when I got a Yaesu FT60. It was relatively inexpensive. These go for about $150. You can replace this radio now with the new model, an FT70. It runs splits. It runs 5 watts. It's great audio, bulletproof, and it's, you know, worth the investment. I must say that, you know, there's a place for Baofeng radios and the cheap Chinese radios, but if you're going to plan on working satellites, this is a good investment for a basic starter radio an FT-70 or even an FT-60 you could buy used, and it'll be great. And of course, an antenna. You want to get a little bit more sophisticated. This is half duplex. So here, you're only transmitting at one time, and then when you key off, then you receive. The TH-D72A, which is this radio, this is a little bit more expensive, about $350, $375. This is full duplex. And so,
still available.
Huh?
Still available.
Still available. And they have a new radio, the 74, but the 74 is not full duplex. This is the full duplex handheld radio to use today. It's a great radio, and it's easy to use. Put this same radio with this antenna, and you could hit all of these AO85, SO50, AO91, 92, and any of these future FM satellites to get started working the FM satellites. For this radio, for the Kenwood, I think I got a slide. Next slide. So here's programming. You need to program the radio. And so this is essentially how I have my radios programmed. So in the memory, you just simply go in and this could be memory 52, 53, 54, whatever, 51. But here's my text message that I put in there so I can see it. And I don't have to worry about the frequencies because I have the frequencies programmed split. But I've got AO91, acquisition of signal, my first step. AO91, acquisition of signal, my second step. And so you can just think about that if you break the satellite pass into five segments and you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you're done. And that's all you gotta worry about. Because there's enough stuff going on, it's kinda like you gotta be patting your head and rubbing your tummy and jumping at the same time when you operate these satellites. Because you've got an antenna in your hand. And so at some point in time, you have to kinda stop and you have to change the frequency. And then you gotta keep going. And if you work somebody, then you gotta write their name down. But there's other ways to do that too. Next slide. So portable satellite antennas. Here you can see the arrow, and here's an elk. So I'm an arrow guy because I like it. It has. But living in the metro area, I think that the arrow antenna gives you a little bit better performance. It's about $150. These satellite antennas are about comparable. The elk is a log periodic. It's easier to set up and to tear down, and it's about the same weight. Patrick is an elk guy. He likes his elks, and I'm an arrow guy, so it's like, it's like viva la difference, but whatever. I find that in the metro area, having UHF and VHF elements perform better for me, because we're under Mount Wilson, and we've got all of this RF and stuff, and I work in a metro area. If you go out Palm Springs and you have an elk, it works great. I have great luck with an elk in Palm Springs because there's no RF environment there to fight against. And then there you are. This is a gentleman operating with his HT on a cruise line, on a cruise ship. So you could do that stealthily. So if you go on a cruise, you could take that prime antenna and you just kind of sneak out on your balcony. Now you can work the satellites even though you're not supposed to be operating on the ship. So I disavow all knowledge of that.
Just hang some monofilament off the end of it and make it look like you're fishing.
That's right. I don't know if you can fish. They're probably going to get you for it not having an international fishing license. Next slide, Bruce. So we talked about different orbits. So there's different orbits here. Low Earth orbit, and that's where all of these satellites live in the 400 or 500 kilometers, miles-ish range. You've got the GPS satellites in an orbit there. You've got geosynchronous, so they're 22,300 miles above the Earth. And then you've got these elliptical orbits where they're called Melonian, and they go way out. So they'll go way out above the Earth and then they'll come back. So they'll spend a satellite that's like that AO40 or the Melonian out there. It could spend maybe 13 hours hanging out there and then comes back and makes a really fast pass on the backside. Next slide. So satellite tracking. Okay, we've talked about radios, we talked about antennas. So we have to, now we have to find out, where's my satellite? So there's a lot of low cost or no cost options. Everybody has got a, nowadays, an iPhone. Even if you have a flip phone, there's a lot of web-based stuff. So you've got this N2YO, AMSAT's got a site, Heavens Above, Orbitron. Those are all places that you can go on the internet, and you can get a bunch of satellites for the next pass. So if you don't want to spend the $9, or if you've got an Android option, there's a free AMSAT droid. If you've got an iPhone, my favorite is ProSat, and that's ProSat's $9. Tremendous program. I go in on a weekend, I'll identify the satellites that I want to work, that are the best passes. I push a button, it says add to my calendar, sends me a reminder an hour before the satellite pass, tells me 5 minutes before the satellite pass, integrates with the phone. It's great, absolutely great, makes it really easy. If you get into the bigger stuff, if you've been with us on field day, I operate more complex with azimuth and elevation rotors and stuff. I use SAT-PC-32. There's also Nova for Windows and Mac Doppler. So those are for the advanced users, but those are very good. And of course, AMSAT supports the SAT-PC-32. Next slide. So again, my personal favorite is HAMSAT or ProSat. And it's really great. And it basically shows you when you're going to get the acquisition of signal, time of closest approach, loss of signal. It shows you when your elevation, so you're going to see, I start cracking 5 degrees, it'll be at its maximum elevation at 29 degrees, and then it'll go down from there. And then what I get is I get this great thing over here, a little radar map, and this moves. So I get to know when the range is and when it gets near 1,000 miles over here, and it puts a little dot right here, and it shows the dot moving, so I know where to point my antenna, and it makes it really, really easy. Next one. So protocols. So you hear the satellite. A lot of guys, a lot of folks, are out there, and they just start trying to transmit and raise anybody. You know, if you can't hear anything, don't transmit, which is, just call in CQ, and you don't want to call CQ. So one of the things you have to do is open the squelch all the way, because the satellites, you're essentially, this is weak signal work. This is talking to somebody on a mountaintop 1,000 miles away. So you can imagine how weak that is. The only difference is that it's got great height above average terrain, and it's right above it. So if you want to test and play, late night passes are really good. And for us out here on the West Coast, any of the passes that are westerly, like out over the ocean where we're feeding fish, I never hear anybody from Hawaii. So you're going to talk to a lot of people on the West Coast when they get out above the Pacific Ocean. That's a great time to be experimenting. And you can still do that at 10, 11, 12 o'clock at night. And a great time to test. You don't want to test when the satellites are east, because now it's doing an overhead pass over the central United States. Move your antenna around if it's not audible or weak. Of course, if you don't hear the satellite, don't transmit. Really experiment. Start to listen for the satellite. And really, antenna orientation makes a lot of difference. You just kind of have to play with the antenna. Pretty soon you're going to hear it. Don't expect to hear anything until the satellite gets within about 1,000 miles. After that, you should start hearing. On transmitting, you have to have tones to activate this. I'm not going to go into detail here, but it's in the material that you've got. And all of the new satellites, AO85, 91, 92, and beyond, are all activated with the tones. CTESS tone, and you have to have that 67 hertz turned on in order for the satellite to listen, to hear you and respond. Next slide. So getting started, again, I said this earlier, it's weak signal work. You're listening to, like I say, 100 watt, a 1 watt radio, 1,000 miles away. Simple antennas, you're working in a moving target. So I love this. So, the satellite is moving at 5,000 miles a second. 5,000 rounds a second. So, you know, it's not like shooting a bullet through a railroad car, but pretty darn close. And that's 17,000 miles per hour.
You sure about 5,000 miles? That doesn't make sense.
A second, yeah.
A second? That's across the whole United States in 1 second.
Just about. It moves fast.
That's...
So Doppler effect, it moves fast. As frequencies move down, transmit frequencies move up again. So that's why you have to have those Doppler changes. This is more critical with the linear birds, and you have more Doppler shift on UHF. Dual band, you know, it's best to listen in your downlink before you transmit. Next slide. And so reference cards, you know, this is going to be complex, and I shouldn't say complex, but you just have to, you know, what are the guidelines? What makes this easy? And so I pass these around, but for full duplex, I made up these cards. And on these cards for my FT72, or THD72A, I made up these cards that basically kind of gives me reminders about how to program the radio for full duplex, which where the frequency should be, because the radio has to be on, what do they say here, VHF has to be on the A band of the transceiver, UHF has to be on the B band, it performs better that way. You have to be sure to program it for full duplex. You've got to open up the squelch, which means you've got to set the balance a certain way. So again, some of the process here for operating full duplex radio is a little bit more complex, but I find that in a lot of the work that I do, I typically have little reference cards, and that helps me out a lot. And if you need help, I'm happy to do that. But fundamentally, once you start working a couple satellites, it just kind of drops into place. You're like, oh, okay, I know how to do that now. Next slide. Again, operating techniques. So I adjust Doppler in 5 kilohertz steps. You'd see that in the chart. You saw that on the earlier chart. Listen who's talking. Note their call sign. Typically, when we talk on the satellite, we like to give grid squares. So we're Delta Mike 04. A lot of people collect grids, and they try to work all the grids, kind of like work all states. So that's a little bit of a game a lot of the satellite folks like to do. I don't collect grids, so I just like to talk to people. Don't say CQ on an FM satellite. That will drive everybody nuts. So just QRZ, AO91 if you don't hear anybody, and work it that way. Have a means to record the contacts. I typically take most of my radios, and I put a splitter in there, just a Y cable, and I hook it up to a cheap digital recorder, and I record the whole pass, because a lot of times, you know, WD9EWK, WA0POD, and I'm going, who did I work? And I remembered him long enough to remember his call, and then I forgot him. And so then after I get all done, I sit down and I write all the stuff down. And you could even just turn this on and put it in your pocket, and you'll hear yourself mimic that call, and then you're gonna know. You don't have to even have any wires to hook this up, but as you can hear, as you heard earlier, it's fun for me to record these and then play them back. So I use a recorder. And again, it's not a gazillion dollars, $50 to buy the cheap Sony digital recorder. I've got like hundreds of contacts that I've never even erased here on these things. So. And have patience. It may take a couple passes, but listen to a couple of these passes go by until you really get into the rhythm of what's going on. You don't have to transmit the first time. It all happens so fast. 15 minutes and it's over. Next one. Logging contacts. I'm not going to go into details. This is really recording it. DH-74A, Patrick has one of those radios. He could record it on his radio. Again, that's way too much stuff for me. And I typically write things down on a scratch pad, and then I transfer them in my log if you want, but you don't have to. Next one. Oh, I want to talk about Logbook of the World. That's, if anybody here use Logbook of the World? Yeah, only just a few of you. But it's very complex, but it's a great way to log contacts, and a lot of satellite guys love Logbook of the World, because that's an easy way to collect those grids, and that's a big deal. So, AMSAT continues the tradition of launching satellites and maintaining them. In the industry, we're an all-volunteer organization. We have one paid employee. You know, if you get into this, I encourage you to join AMSAT. If you're interested in this, join AMSAT. Use the AMSAT website. There's a tremendous amount of resource out there. There's a lot of videos on the web, on YouTube, lots and lots of stuff like we all have. You'll learn a lot. Next slide. AMSAT Journal, you get that every 2 months. It's a great resource again. I always look forward to getting the AMSAT Journal good articles. We have an AMSAT bullet board, we get multiple email blasts every day that tell us what's going on. I never was into social media. My wife, lovely wife Rebecca, is very much into everything social media, but I don't have a Facebook account, and I never had a Twitter account, but I have a Twitter account now, and I have hundreds of followers because I'm on the satellites all the time. Patrick's got thousands. So, you know, it's really a neat community, but it's kind of like the back office intercom for all the satellite guys. And once you get connected to somebody like Patrick or myself in the satellite community, you get all these Twitter alerts. And it's great. It's kind of like, you really learn a lot. And I really, believe it or not, I enjoy Twitter. So I have to, if anybody has any questions, we had dinner tonight, Patrick and I had dinner tonight at a burger place down by Best Buy. And when they served us, believe it or not, our table card number was 73. and so we took that table card number, we posted it on Twitter, and of course the community went nuts over that. That was fun. So it was great. Next slide. AMSAT. Join AMSAT. Next slide. And I want to thank Patrick, because Patrick had given me some of the fundamental elements for this presentation. I've changed it, enhanced it. Hopefully he likes it. And thanks to the AMSAT and launch providers that we've referenced here in these presentations and the Fox series. So all of my stuff came from the National Reconnaissance Office and Fox. So those are my references. This is all about me. If you want to know any more, here's my phone number, my email. I'm happy to help you get on the satellites, and help you with anything you might need. Next slide. Okay, now I have two comments here before I'll take any questions, because we talked about it. Right now there used to be a program called AMSAT Eagle, and that was for a high Earth orbit elliptical satellite. Now they're talking about they changed the name now, kind of died, and it's called GOLF, G-O-L-F. It's greater orbit, larger footprint. So the concept is to take a 3-cube satellite and launch it into a higher orbit and more power, and it's going to have a higher orbit, and it's going to have a bigger footprint. So right now, when a satellite like AO-91 is over the United States, we'll get domestic coverage, national coverage, from coast to coast. When it's over and it's exciting, because also when it's over the Atlantic or the Pacific, you're able to talk to the Europe or to Asia via these satellites. So that's pretty cool. Now, very likely, unlikely that you'll be talking to Europe, but you'll be talking to Asia for sure from here, and you can do that very easily. That's GOLF, and that's one of the new initiatives that AMSAT is going to start looking into next. And then we've also got a program for a geostationary platform that's kind of in the process of development now. They've kind of coined it 5 and dime, 5 and 10, and this is a geostationary satellite. We've got a government satellite, can't remember which part of the agency it is, but it's a reconnaissance satellite. And it will have, they're giving us kind of space, we're renting an apartment. We're gonna get space on the satellite, and we're gonna get power from their power bus. So now, all those guys that we talked about earlier, the science experiments, like from the Vanderbilt University, the road along with us. We get a ride along on this this reconnaissance satellite, and so we will have, I think it's 10 gigahertz up, 5 gigahertz down.
The reverse.
5 gigahertz.
5 up, 10 down.
5 up, 10 down. Thank you, Patrick. And so that will be an L-band converter, and it will be able to hook up a standard HF rig to this converter, and for about $1,000, and an antenna the size of a DirecTV antenna, be stationary outside your home, and you'll have 24/7 access to a geostationary satellite that's out there in a geostationary position. Very exciting. This will be used for disaster recovery. It'll be a hemispherical satellite, so you won't, it's not going to be rotating. It will cover the northern and southern hemispheres, and you'll be able to, it'll be like always up, kind of like your repeater on Mount Wilson. So it's going to be very exciting. It'll be channelized. I don't know all the details about it, but that's it. It's very promising, and it's the next, one of the next phases of AMSAT Mark.
Well, for it to be geostationary, it's going to be out, have to be out pretty far.
That's right.
What kind of resolution will it have?
Well, resolution you mean?
Pixelization.
This is FM. This is a communication satellite. No pictures.
Oh, okay. So there's no video. No.
No video. Okay. It's basically voice communication, voice and data.
Okay. And video could be transmitted by, you know, digital video could be transmitted.
Right.
You
could transmit any sort of IP traffic.
Okay. Because when you said reconnaissance, I was thinking, you know,
well, reconnaissance for the government. We don't want to have access to that part of the satellite.
They're on the same bus, aren't they?
No. The only thing we get is we get to tap into the battery.
Get electronics.
And